Hello, my friends. Dennis Prager here. Every third hour on Tuesday is devoted to some great issue of life. Because without clarity on the great issues, we have a map only of the roads we're on, but we have no idea where we're going, which is increasingly a problem. And since I believe, as my guest does, I have every so often a guest on the Ultimate Issues Hour, so you can get an idea of how much I appreciate the person's work. Or, by the way, sometimes I have a person that I strongly differ with. In this case, it is someone I happen to agree with. And he cites the notion that ideas have consequences. One of the consequences is the death of humanity, which, ironically, is the title of his book. So, it is time for me to introduce my guest. He is Richard Weikart. And Richard Weikart is a professor of modern European history at California State University, Stanislaus, and a senior fellow at the Discovery Institute's Center for Science and Culture. I am a huge fan of the Discovery Institute. I've had a number of their people on. They have major thinkers writing major stuff. The book, The Death of Humanity and the Case for Life. And Professor Weikart, welcome to the Dennis Prager Show.
Yes, thanks for having me, Dennis.
So you're afraid that we have entered a period in large measure because of the radical secularization of our culture that human life is simply worthless. Is that a fair summary?
Yes. I think we've already entered that, though. I don't know if fear of it. I think we're already there, at least in certainly the intellectual spheres of our culture and civilization in the Western world. We're already there in many respects. And I'm hoping we can turn things back, though. I don't think we have to stay there. So I'm hoping that we can do something about it, and that's part of what my book's about, trying to do something to speak the truth to this generation to try to bring us back from that culture of death.
All right, so let's use example after example. What's an example or two or three of the culture of death?
Well, California just passed an assisted suicide bill, for one, which is bringing us further and further to the notion that humans at the end stages of their life have no value or significance or meaning to them, and it flows from these kind of secular philosophies that I'm critiquing there. But there's some places that are even further gone than the United States in this respect. Belgium and the Netherlands and Switzerland in particular in Europe are even further along the road to this death. And so let me give you a couple examples from there just to show you where we're going if we keep going the way we're going. In Switzerland, they have what's called suicide tourism, where if you're dissatisfied with your life, you're in depression, despair, whatever, you can fly to Switzerland, not to enjoy the Alps and recover and, you know, go back rejuvenated, but to kill yourself there, and for just about any reason. There's a lady in Italy who was in her late 50s, early 60s, I forgot exactly, but it was somewhere around there, and she noticed that as she was aging, she was losing some of her physical beauty, and so she despaired of that and decided to go to Switzerland and end it all, and they accommodated her. There's a lady from England who was a retired art teacher, and she thought she was losing touch with the new technologies of this world and didn't feel like she sort of fit into the new ways of doing things with all the smartphones and everything else, and so she went to Switzerland to have herself killed. I could give you example after example of these kinds of things, and you think, what in the world are we thinking about? Why are we as a society accommodating these people rather than giving them the love that they need to, you know, dissuade them from ending their lives? But once you buy the idea that human life doesn't really have any meaning or significance or purpose, then why not let them commit suicide?
All right. Now, do you, considering your culture of death and the book, The Death of Humanity, the 20th century's genocides, is that part of it?
Oh, yeah. In fact, I go back to the 18th century when I sort of try to look at the roots of it. I'm a historian, of course. So I go back to the Enlightenment period in the 18th century as sort of a pivotal turning point toward this process of secularization that then is going to take a couple of centuries to pick up steam and to gain more adherence and to permeate, especially into the larger popular culture from the intellectual realms that it starts out at. And one of the key episodes that I identify in the Enlightenment is a beginning of what was called the Radical Enlightenment. And notice it's the Radical Enlightenment. It wasn't the mainstream Enlightenment. The mainstream Enlightenment was still believing in things like Thomas Jefferson put into the Declaration of Independence, where he said that all men are created equal and are endowed by their Creator with inalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But the Radical Enlightenment was buying into a materialist philosophy, philosophical materialism. They denied any kind of God, and so they also denied human rights. They denied that there was any kind of objective morality. And so once they got rid of God, they also got rid of any kind of value for humanity, really. And in the 18th century, the way this played itself out in terms of concrete discussions was it opened up a debate about suicide. And in the 18th century, there was this big debate about the propriety of suicide. And David Hume, a very famous British philosopher of the 18th century, wrote justifying suicide at that time. In fact, in the essay, he says that a human life is no more valuable than an oyster. That was his perspective.
That's actually his terminology?
Yes, that's what he said, that human life is no more valuable than an oyster.
Well, that it isn't, actually. I mean, if there is no divine image, then I challenge anybody, and you obviously do too, because you note that animal rights movement is not so much about animals as it is about humans.
Sure, exactly right. Yeah, and I agree with you, once you dispense that. What's interesting, though, in the course of my book, one thing I try to do is I try to show that a lot of these secular thinkers themselves are not able to live with that or be consistent with their own philosophies. So they can say, and like these 18th century radical materialists did, and by the way, one of those radical materialists wrote a book, this is a guy named Lemaître. He wrote a book that was called Man the Machine. And so essentially he just thought humans are just a machine. And so because of that, there's no worth, there's no value, no purpose in their lives. We're just a bunch of machines. And that's what I actually titled my first chapter of my book. I call it Man the Machine, and I look at how many secular philosophies, especially materialist philosophies, have reduced humans to just being a machine. But then also my second chapter is created from animals, where I look at how we reduce humans to being just another animal. So you're suggesting this animal rights connection that, you know, you're right. It's about demoting humanity from its position as having any kind of specialness or any being in a divine image and such. And so that's another way then of trying to attack the value of humanity then at that particular time. But then I do go up, and you asked earlier about the genocides and other things like that. Oh, yeah, I do go up and I talk about how a lot of different ideologies, not just materialism, but then building on that on into the 19th century when you get Marxism, other forms of socialism, I discuss those extensively and the way that they devalued human life, utilitarianism.
So there's a certain irony here that the people who call themselves humanists have actually degraded the worth of humans.
Exactly. And I try to point the tension between those two things, because you're right. At some level, many of these secular thinkers recognize that there is some kind of value of human life. And this comes through in a lot of their thinking. Let me just give one perfect example of this. Bertrand Russell was one of the most foremost philosophers in Britain in the early 20th century. And he claimed that there was no purpose to human life when he was making his philosophical statements. He claimed that human life, that all of our hopes and fears, he said in one writing, he said, are just an accidental collocation of atoms. So just accidents is where these atoms happen to be located. That's what brought about human life. So he has this vision of humanity that's very bleak. But then he got jailed for protesting against nuclear arms. Why is he protesting against nuclear arms? Because at some level he knows that human life does have value. He knows we shouldn't be blowing each other up. So there's a sense in
which he was really strange, because he at one point advocated dropping a bomb on Moscow. He was a I'm aware of the guy, but you're entirely right. This really is a great introduction easily read but filled with the data on what has happened to the worth of the human being. It's called The Death of Humanity. The professor who wrote it is Richard Weikart. I have a lot more questions, and if you do, it's 1-8-PRAGER-776. Hi, everybody. You're listening to the Dennis Prager Show. This is the Ultimate Issues Hour, third hour every Tuesday, some great issue of life. We've been doing this for about, I don't know, 10 years? How many years is the Ultimate Issues Hour? It's we started with the Happiness Hour in 1999, then we went to a male-female hour, I don't know, about 5 years later, and then 5 years after that, I think. Ultimate Issues Hour, they're very popular, and I'm very proud of that fact because they're very serious subjects. People crave, actually, for clarity on great subjects. I do, so I would imagine others would, too. On a number of occasions in the course of the year, and not a large number, but sometimes I think it's significant, I do have a guest on the Ultimate Issues Hour. In this case, I do think it's significant. Richard Weikart is a professor at Cal State University, and he has written The Death of Humanity. He has a book coming out, incidentally, later this year, Hitler's Religion, and I am very, very interested in that. I will touch upon that later, even though we're talking about this book. But I want to give people an idea of why I consider this important, because listeners to my show will know that you and I resonate so completely that that's a given to them. But the value of this book, aside from the clarity, is that it's got so many footnotes. For example, in other words, it has data, not just a presentation of his ideas. So, for example, listen to this. In August 2005, the London Zoo opened a special primate display, a four-day exhibit of Homo sapiens. Visitors gawked at eight humans wearing bathing suits with fig leaves pinned on. It's funny they would use a biblical analogy, isn't it?
Yeah.
In some sense, this was a publicity stunt, but it also had a serious purpose. A zoo spokesperson explained, quote, "Seeing people in a different environment among other animals teaches members of the public that the human is just another primate." Right? One of the people on display, a 26-year-old chemist, reflected on the takeaway message of the exhibit. "A lot of people think humans are above other animals. When they see humans as animals here, it kind of reminds us that we're not that special." Worse yet, the zoo issued a communique that explained the intent of the exhibit was, quote, "to highlight the spread of man as a plague species." Okay, so there you got it. We're just, it used to be, people would say, so the planet consists of humans and animals, but now they say the planet consists of humans and other animals. The language has added one word to demote us to animal status. I remember that story, but I didn't remember it till I reread it in your book. That's one of the great values of the book. The book is up, incidentally, at DennisPrager.com, The Death of Humanity. So this animal thing, are you aware of the PETA, the People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, their program, Holocaust on Your Plate?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
You are?
Yeah, it's actually, I mentioned it in the book, in fact.
Oh, good, good, because I didn't get through it all. Go ahead, tell everybody.
Oh, yeah, they went to various cities throughout the United States with the placards where they had pictures on one side of the Holocaust of people packed into some of these death camps and such, and then they had placards on the other side of chickens that are caged and such, and they were campaigning, calling people who were eating animals, it's Holocaust on your plate. So you were committing Holocaust by eating chickens or
yep.
whatever other kind of animals you're eating on your plate. So, and they also, very interestingly, there was a a campaign against Colonel Sanders, too, that went on with PETA. I think it was PETA that did that one also, some animal rights group. I'm pretty sure it was PETA also, where they had up on their website a picture of Colonel Sanders with some diabolical, devilish horns sticking out of his head and stuff. You know, that Colonel Sanders is the devil incarnate, apparently, because he's killing chickens. So, you know, they're equating these people with Himmler, who, by the way, interestingly, was a chicken farmer. They didn't mention that in their publicity. I'm surprised, actually. But they're equating these guys with Himmler and Hitler and such because they're killing animals.
Right.
And such.
Well, the interesting thing is there is a book written by a Princeton professor, the name of him and the book I don't recall, many, about 20 years ago. And it is about the pro-animal aspect, the animal rights aspect of Nazis and Nazism.
It's probably Peter Singer, I'm guessing. I mean,
Not
Singer?
No, because I know Singer was at Princeton, but I don't think he would have. The last thing he would want to do is show how the Nazis were very into animal rights.
Oh, okay. I get you. I thought you were saying the other way around. Okay.
Yeah. No. Right. It was really just a scholarly book on that fact. There was a cartoon of, in fact, I believe it was Himmler, ironically, a cartoon in a Nazi publication in Germany of animals doing Heil Hitler to Himmler, thanking the Nazis for how much they cared about animals.
Yeah, they passed anti-vivisection. Yeah, Himmler was very opposed to vivisection, for example.
Yeah, yeah. But okay on humans. But they experimented on humans.
Yeah, exactly.
Not animals.
Yeah. Because, again, once you reduce humans to an animal, then sort of anything goes with humans. You know, there's another powerful example that I use in my book, too, to demonstrate the kind of mentality that some of this animal rights and environmental rights kind of stuff comes to. Eric Pianka, who is a University of Texas evolutionary biologist who specializes in lizards, and he gave a talk, I believe it was 2006, if I recall correctly, at the Texas Academy of Science. He was being given an award there, and he suggested in his talk that it would be a good thing if 90% of the people on the globe were to be killed by some kind of Ebola virus. This is way before we had this huge Ebola outbreak, too, in West Africa. But he was hoping that some Ebola could become aerosol, perhaps somehow would mutate or something to become aerosol, and thus could wipe out 90% of the population of the globe. And he thought that'd be a great thing to happen.
I know. There is a part of the environmentalist movement that deep down, and sometimes not just deep down, does believe that the humans are a blight on the planet.
Oh, yeah.
We'll be back in a moment. I had a lot of very interesting calls, including a challenge I want to take from what we call a millennial on the issue of atheism and meaning. The book is The Death of Humanity. Richard Weikart is a professor of European history at California State University. He's the book is up at DennisPrager.com. He's also author of the forthcoming book, The Religion of Hitler. So he writes on the big themes that are critical. This is the Ultimate Issues Hour. I'm Dennis Prager. We return in a moment. Been reduced, and the author of this important new book explains why. The Death of Humanity, Richard Weikart. Weikart, professor of European history at Cal State University, California State University, and a senior fellow at the Discovery Institute. So I'm curious, I assume you have tenure?
Oh, yeah.
I ask all professors who come on my show how lonely they feel. I have liberal professors, too, but the conservative professors, and especially those with a religious bent, are you lonely there?
Well, there aren't many of us here, so in that sense. Actually, my colleagues in my department, though, are actually pretty encouraging, actually, even though they don't agree with me ideologically. They actually are a pretty good group, so I get some flack from outside my department from other places, but I have actually pretty collegial colleagues here. But in terms of sharing my views, no, there aren't very many of them.
Now, do you teach any courses that reflect your understanding of the devaluation of the human as a result of secularization?
Well, actually, a lot of what's in my book, The Death of Humanity, comes out of a course I teach on modern European intellectual history. where I talk about all these different ideologies and look at them. And I'm not just looking at them at the angle of the devaluing of human life, which my book does. My book sort of hones in on that one aspect of it. But I do talk about these issues in my classes sometimes, too. It's very interesting. I mean, I'm in a little bit more conservative place. My students are a little bit more conservative than, say, maybe in the San Francisco Bay Area. I'm in the Central Valley of California. It's more agricultural, more rural to some degree. And I do get a little bit more conservative
to some degree.
And it's interesting because some of the times when I'm teaching some of these things about some of these intellectuals and the ideas that they're saying, students will look at me quizzically and say, "You mean someone really believes this?"
You get that.
Yeah, I do get that sometimes. But, of course, you have other students that, you know, buy into all this kind of stuff, too.
Right. Well, my listeners know how much I would enjoy your work, because I have said often, you might find this of interest, if I had to summarize my life's work, it would be pointing out to people the consequences of secularism.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody knows the bad consequences of religion.
Mm-hmm.
And there have been bad consequences, and I am religious, but I acknowledge it. But nobody talks about the bad consequences of secularism.
And one of the interesting things is that secularism has no moral fulcrum by which to even criticize
religion. Exactly.
But they do it anyway.
That's right.
You know,
that's
religion,
right.
According to Dawkins, is the root of all evil, even
right.
though he doesn't think there is such a thing as evil.
That's right. Beautifully said. That's exactly right. Let's go to some calls. We'll begin with that millennial that I noted earlier in Joliet, Illinois. It's Kevin, Dennis Prager, and Professor Richard Weikart.
Hi, Dennis. Hi, Richard. How are you guys doing today?
Hi.
Good.
Thank you for taking my call. First thing I would like to state, I just have a couple of comments and then a question. Well, as an atheist, I don't believe that we were... You know, we're descendants of apes or anything like that. I don't subscribe to the evolutionary theory. Two, as far as animals are concerned, you know, we share 2%. There's only 2% difference between genetic material of humans and everything else on the planet. So to say that we're different from animals to me is scientifically flawed.
Forgive me, because I know you're going to go to another point. It's the only reason I'm mentioning this. I actually wish that we were 100% the same, because then it would make the argument for the divine spark even more remarkable. You look at it and sit and draw one conclusion. I look at it and draw the opposite. Look at how similar we are genetically, and yet how utterly and totally different we are. Well, so how do we explain the difference in the 2%? It's got to be something non-scientific.
Well, here's my take on it. I've done a lot of research into alternative knowledge, and it's very likely, especially given the evidence, looking at the human genome, and especially looking at the flaws of evolution, that it's likely that humans are an engineered species. You know, we only have 46 chromosomes. Apes have 48. It's highly unlikely that we evolved, but is it unlikely that, you know, superior beings from somewhere else engineered humanity with their own DNA and
You think we are engineered, but not by God?
No, I'm not saying there is no God. I would never claim definitively.
I thought you said you were an atheist.
I am an atheist, but atheism is simply a response to.
Okay, all right. We'll continue in a moment. I got to take a break. Talking to Richard Weikart, his book, The Death of Humanity. Hello, my friends. Dennis Prager here with Professor Richard Weikart, W-E-I-K-A-R-T, The Death of Humanity. How inevitably it is such, and I only because of time, forgive me, Kevin and Joliet, but he called in as well, among other things, to say that he thinks meaning is possible because we can define it ourselves. Forgive me, Professor, I just want to hail that for 1 minute and then move back to you. The notion that we can make up our own meaning because that's something just people want to do needs to be answered. Every atheist says, well, if you make up God, then obviously God is nonsense. So then let's be honest then. And by the way, they're right. If you make up God, God is nonsense. Either there is one or there isn't one. But if you make one up and you know you're making it up, then obviously it doesn't exist. So too with meaning. If you make one up, then you should be intellectually honest and understand it doesn't exist. That's all. Be consistent. If you make up God, God doesn't exist. If you make up meaning, meaning doesn't exist. Okay? Because people, again, Professor, people don't want, that's why your book is so important. People don't want to acknowledge the consequences of the death of God.
Exactly. And your response is exactly right. They change the meaning of the word meaning is what they do.
Well, and they don't apply the same criterion.
Yeah, exactly.
You make up God, there is no God, but you make up meaning, there really is meaning. No, you can't do it that way.
Right.
If you made it up, you made it up.
Yep.
Let's go to some more of your calls here. And let's go to Henya in Crown Heights in Brooklyn, New York. Hi, Henya. Dennis Prager.
Hi. What an honor to speak with you.
Thank you.
And the gentleman, oh, what a breath of fresh air. Oh, my God. I agree with everything he says, but I have a question, but I really have so many comments. We'll see how fast we can do it.
No. Ask the question, or you won't get to the question. Ask the question first.
Okay, this is really rhetorical.
Okay, rhetorical questions are accepted.
Between saving a rat or a human being from drowning, who do you think the humanist would save? And I just wanted to comment that my father, I'm an Orthodox Jew, was a shochet. He did kosher slaughtering. And he once told us that when people would come and they would complain why he, quote-unquote, kills a chicken, he would say, I don't kill the chicken. I shecht it. At first I say blessing, and then I ask permission, and he would feed them, and my father would kiss the chicken and pat it on its beak, and then he would slaughter it only for food. And he once told us, how could they eat something like an apple or bread? Did you ever see what it's like to take an apple off a tree? You have to rip it. How do you know that doesn't hurt? Just because you can't hear the apple cry?
Well, as it happens, there are vegans who won't eat apples. They won't tear an apple off a tree. They wait till it falls. This is an interesting point. You might want to deal with that. I have asked this my whole life. Would you save your dog or a stranger, Professor, if both were drowning? And I've gotten the same results since I began asking this question in my 20s. One-third say the dog, one-third say the stranger, and one-third don't know.
Yeah, that's pretty tragic when you think about it. But if you think about what a lot of bioethicists are saying today in terms of, you know, who has more value, many bioethicists are dividing the human species into two groups, one which they call persons and one which they call non-persons. And the people that get relegated to the non-person status, if they're consistent with their ideology, they would say they are more valuable. So the people relegated to the non-persons are less valuable, rather. The non-persons would be, according to many bioethicists today, including Peter Singer being foremost, but there's many others, too, who buy into the same kind of ideology. Non-persons would be people who are unborn, humans that are unborn, even some after they're born. And there's talk these days about afterbirth abortions. That's a word being used in medical.
Well, Singer is for that. He's for a 28-day leeway to kill your child.
Exactly. And a couple of years ago, there was an article in the Journal of Medical Ethics that was pushing for afterbirth abortions, and they used that terminology for it to try to justify it and such. And then,
well, Gosnell did that in Philadelphia.
Sure.
He did afterbirth abortions. The child was out of the womb and alive, and then he killed it.
Exactly. These bioethicists, though, are calling for in all sorts of hospitals that parents should have the right to decide after the child's been born for, and they, a lot of times don't specify exactly how long, but they're just calling for infanticide, plain and simple. And then once people reach positions of mental disability or senility or whatever, too, then those people are also, many bioethicists consider them sort of non-persons. And so then we can kill them as well. And so what's happening is that we've eroded this idea of human equality by claiming that there's certain people because they don't have, and usually it's cognitive faculties usually is what they're focusing on. If you don't have the right cognitive faculties,
well, that's interesting, because that's what the Nazis did before the Jews. Life unworthy of life.
Exactly.
That's what they called it.
Exactly. That's exactly right. And they killed...
All right, so I have a question for you, and it's not the purview exactly of your book, but I am curious. I'm sure you've thought about it, and I'm very interested to know, if you have, what you've come up with. You may find this of interest. I now ask atheists one question. I've debated all of them except for Dawkins, all of them. And but I never asked this until later on, and I wish I had always done it. And this is, that is, do you hope you're right or wrong? What I don't understand is those who are enthusiastic atheists. So when we come back, I would like you to tell me your thought. Why? I understand why people don't believe in God, but I do not understand why people would want not to believe that there is a God. Why would they not want to believe that they will meet their loved ones again in an afterlife, that there is ultimate reward and punishment, that there is actual objective meaning to life? So in other words, why do you think people have embraced atheism enthusiastically? The book, The Death of Humanity, Richard Weikart, it is up at my website. We shall return.
Paint me a picture that I can see. Give me a touch that I can feel. Turn me around. So
stay
I
on if I don't get to call you, because I'm going to try to summarize some of them. And Kevin, you still there?
Yeah.
So, Kevin, I wish we had an hour, actually, just you and I. I would like to convince you, because you're obviously thoughtful and you have some respect for me, so there's a good combination.
I agree. Thank you.
Right. Well, good. I'm glad. I want you to wrestle with the fact that if there is no God, and I'm not trying to convince you that there is, I want to convince you only, not of a faith statement, but of a fact. Meaning, a meaningful universe is dependent upon a meaningful creator. If it's all coincidence, you are nothing more than a self-conscious rock.
In a sense, yeah. I don't necessarily claim that there is no God. I'm of the perspective that I would like to believe that there is, but I don't have any strong...
All right. Well, even that's a good sign. So all I would say is, in light of the subject of this Ultimate Issues Hour, that you give religion a chance and keep your and retain your questions. But it is a richer life. It just is. How could it not be? To elevate Sunday in the case of Christianity, Saturday in the case of Judaism, it's just on another football day or another shopping day or another work day. To bring the holy into one's life, these are very big deals. So anyway, it's about shopping for religion. And Todd in Cleveland found Catholicism. And let's see, less of a community feeling. Used to be a Baptist. You need to find a religion that serves you. Well, yeah, I mean, it's not your words necessarily, but we have to serve it too, obviously. Anyway, Daniel in Reno, Nevada, and Matt in Sterling Heights, Michigan, and Gregory in Sacramento, and Lewis in Phoenix, all important calls, and it's the pain of the talk show host that he can't take them all. But please consider my thinking and do shop for a religion. It's not deep being a nun, N-O-N-E. I'm Dennis Prager. This has been the Ultimate Issues Hour.